We can now define what is a copula function. So in the rest of this chapter, we will always work in the two-dimensional situation. So I have a random vector x1, x2. x1, x2 can be losses or can be income random variables depending on the situation. So assume that we have data available for x1. So this data, so we have a data set available for x1, and this data can be used to determine the marginal distribution of x1, so the CDF fx1. Similarly, we can use data about the random variable x2 to determine the CDF fx2. So now we have two random variables x1 and x2. We have information about the distribution function of x1. We have information about the distribution function of x2. But assume that we do not know anything about the dependence. We do not know anything about how x1 and x2 are moving together. So remember the last three slides of the previous part, that we also had, each time we had different situations where the marginals did not change, but the dependence structure could be very different. Even if the marginals are always the same, you can have positive or negative dependence. You can have upper tail dependence, you can have lower tail dependence. So it looks like dependence is another important ingredient that we need before we can make any statements about our random variable vector x1, x2. So we're looking at this problem where the marginal CDFs are known, but the dependence is not known. So how can we use the marginals to build a dependence structure? And what we need, and that is what we will see later on, is we will need copula functions to connect these marginals. And it is important to use copula functions because different copula functions will give different joint CDFs for the random vector x1, x2, and therefore will give different probabilities of having extreme losses for x1, x2 at the same time, or extreme gains for x1, x2 at the same time. We start with the definition of a copula function. So a bivariate copula C is a joint CDF for a bivariate random vector u1, u2, where u1 and u2 are both uniformly distributed. So it means that a copula function applied on some values u1, u2 is a probability. Because it's a joint CDF, it's exactly this probability. And because it is a probability, it should take values in 0, 1. Because a copula function is a joint CDF of u1, u2, where u1 and u2 are uniformly distributed, it should start in 0, 1, 0, 1. So it means that we take the square 0, 1 and 0, 1. So it's this area. And a copula function, C, maps each of the values in this green space to a probability. And if we take u1 here, u2 here, then a copula function C gives C u1 u2, and this is a probability that the random vector u1 u2 takes values in this red area. So again, very simple, a copula function C is just a joint CDF, and therefore it gives you probabilities. A copula function C is a joint CDF. So we have that C u1 u2, it's the probability that the uniform random variable u1 is smaller than u1, and the uniform random variable u2 is smaller than u2. A uniform random variable takes value between 0 and 1. So if u1 is equal to 0, then we find that this joint probability has to be equal to 0. So it means that in order for C to be a valid joint CDF, property 1 should hold. And because the random variable u1 and the random variable u2 cannot be bigger than 1, in order for C to be a valid joint CDF, also property 2 should hold. So if we define a copula C as a joint CDF of a random vector with uniform marginals, we directly find that property 1 and property 2 here should hold. What is property 3, this one? Assume that we take U1 here, V1 here, U2 here, V2 here. Then we can use the copula function C to determine the probability that the random vector U1, U2 lies in this square. And because it's a probability, this probability should be bigger than zero. So what we have here is that we can start from the definition on the previous slide. If we have that definition, we define the function C as being a joint CDF for a random vector U1, U2 with uniform marginals, then property 1, 2, 3 on this slide should hold in order to make sure that all properties, all probabilities are okay. You can show that also the other way around works. If you find a function C that satisfies these three properties, then the function C is a joint CDF for a random vector with uniform marginals, and hence it is a copula. So you can now use this definition or the definition of the previous slide. They are equivalent. You can use both to define the copula function. One of the most important results in copula theory is Sklar's theorem. So assume you have a bivariate random vector x1, x2. And this random vector has a joint CDF fx. So this joint CDF contains information about the marginal distributions and about the dependent structure. So once you have the joint CDF, you can determine any probability for the random vector x1, x2. We assume additionally that we have continuous and strictly increasing marginals. So if this holds, then Sklar's theorem decomposes the joint CDF in two parts. You have the marginals fx1 and fx2, and you have a function, a copula function C, that couples these marginals such that you find back the joint CDF. So if you have a joint CDF fx, you can always split this joint CDF in marginal information using the marginal distributions fx1 and fx2, and dependence information using the unique copula function C. So thanks to Sklar's theorem, we know that investigating dependence is equivalent with investigating the properties of a copula function. How can we use Sklar's theorem in practice when we have a random vector? So let's first look at the first application. So assume you have two losses x1, x2, and assume that for some reason you already have the joint CDF. For example, you have built a joint model for x1, x2, you have data, and you estimate your model, you now have a joint CDF. So you can use this joint CDF to determine your important probabilities. For example, you used your joint CDF to determine the probability that both x1 and x2 take very high losses at the same time. Okay, so that's good. But sometimes you want to investigate the effect of only the dependence. You want to see how does the dependence structure look like in my model. And if I investigate the joint CDF, then I can investigate the probabilities, but these probabilities combine marginal and dependence information. So it would be nice if I can extract only the dependence information and leave the marginal information behind. So in that case, we can use this formula, because Sklar's theorem tells you that the joint CDF is a mixture of the copula function and the marginals. So if I look at the joint CDF, and I have already estimated the joint CDF, so I know the joint CDF, I look at the inverse CDFs of the marginals, then this function is exactly the copula function I'm looking for. So if I know the joint CDF, I can use this formula to extract the copula function, and then I can investigate the important properties of my dependent structure only without having any margin information. Another application is the second one. So assume that you already determined the marginal. So you had data for x1, you have data for x2. You use this data to determine the marginal distribution fx1 and the marginal distribution fx2. So now you want to go to the next step. You want to build a joint model. So then Sklar's theorem tells you that you can apply this formula, because if you have the right copula C, you can use this copula to connect the marginals, you find back the joint CDF. If you don't know, for example, what the copula function is, you can try different copulas on the same marginals. So you can use different copulas, and for each copula you find a different joint CDF. And for example, you can investigate the effect of using different copulas, hence different dependent structures, on your probabilities. Let's look at two special copulas. So the first one is the combinatonic copula. So assume you have two random variables, x1 and x2. Then we say that x1 and x2 are combinatonic if and only if x1, x2 are in distribution equal to this expression here. So if you look at the right-hand side of this expression, you see that there is only one random source in this expression. It's the uniform random variable u. Moreover, the inverse distribution functions fx1 minus 1 and fx2 minus 1 are increasing functions. So then you see that if my random source u is increasing, both x1 and x2 will be increasing. If the random source u is decreasing, then both x1 and x2 will be decreasing. So if x1 and x2 are combinatonic, it means that I can write the vector in this way, then they're moving perfectly together, meaning that there is only one random source that drives x1 and x2 in the same direction. So commonality for x1 and x2 is a form of extreme positive dependence. So the random variables x1 and x2 are moving together and are perfectly moving together. So assume we have a combinatonic random vector x1 and x2, then we find that the CDF, the joint CDF of the combinatonic vector, is given by this expression. So let me give a proof of this expression. So x1, x2 is combinatonic. So that means that I can write x1, x2 as the inverse of the first random variable evaluated in some uniform random variable u, and the second inverse also evaluated in u. So then I look at the joint CDF, so fx in x1, x2 is the probability that x1 is smaller than x1 and x2 is smaller than x2. So that's the definition of a joint CDF. So now I use the commonality property. So I use that x1 is, I can write it in this way, and the same for the second random variable. So now I use this equivalence relation between inverses that we showed in the first part. So basically it tells you that you can put this to the other side, same for here. So we had the proof for that result earlier. So I find that u is smaller than fx1, x1. And the second inequality gives you this thing here. But if you look at the two arguments, then I have the same u here and here. So u has to be smaller than fx1 in x1, and u has to be smaller than fx2 in x2. So then you automatically find that u should be smaller than the minimum of these two. So u has to be smaller than the minimum of these two probabilities. And because this one and this one are probabilities, so they are in 0, 1, then the minimum is also in 0, 1. And if I take a uniform distribution, then I find that this is equal to the minimum of fx1, x1, and fx2, x2, which proves the result. Okay, so we have shown that the joint CDF of a comatonic random vector is equal to this expression. Then by using Sklar's theorem, we find that we can express this joint CDF of the comatonic random vector x1, x2 using the copula CU. So there is only one copula CU, which is the comatonic copula, and this comatonic copula is then given by this expression. Yeah, so we started from a comatonic random vector, then we derived the joint CDF, and from the joint CDF we go to the comatonic copula. Another extreme dependent structure is countermonotonicity. So the random vector x1, x2 is countermonotonic if this relation holds. So x1, x2 can be written in this way. So first of all, similar to comatonicity, countermonotonicity means that x1, x2 depend on the same random variable u. So there is only one random source u that determines what x1 and x2 will be. But if you look at the expression for countermonotonic random variables, then you see that if u increases, x1 will increase, but because I use 1 minus u for x2, this thing will be decreasing. So countermonotonicity, as the name tells it, is the opposite of comatonicity. What was comatonicity? Comatonicity was two random variables x1, x2 moving perfectly together. Countermonotonicity means two random variables x1, x2 using perfectly in the opposite direction. If one goes up, the other one goes down. In case the random vector x1, x2 is countermonotonic, we can again derive an expression for the joint CDF of this random vector. So we will give the proof on a separate page. So let's for the moment assume that we believe that this is the correct expression for the joint CDF of a countermonotonic random vector. Then we use Sklar's theorem to express this joint CDF as the copula function CL that connects the marginals fx1 and fx2. Combining this and this expression then leads to this expression for CL. So again, similar to the comatonic case, we start with the joint CDF for our countermonotonic random vector, and then we use Sklar's theorem to determine the countermonotonic copula, which is this function. We still need to prove that expression for the joint CDF of a countermonotonic random vector. So let's do that now. So x1, x2 is countermonotonic, and we are looking for an expression for the joint CDF fx in x1, x2. So a joint CDF is this probability. And because we have a countermonotonic random vector, we can write this probability as fx1 minus 1 u and fx2, but then fx2 minus 1 in 1 minus u. Countermonotonicity do we have. In the next step, I can put these inverses to the other sides. And I find then that u should be smaller than fx1 in x1, and 1 minus u has to be smaller than fx2 in x2. This probability is the same as saying that u is smaller than, I don't change anything on the first part, and 1 minus u smaller than fx2 in x2 is the same as u being bigger than 1 minus fx2 in x2. This u and this u are the same, is the same random variable. So what I find is that u should be bigger than 1 minus fx2 in x2, And it should be smaller than fx1, fx1 in x1. And then there are two possibilities. First, assume that fx1 in x1 is smaller than 1 minus fx2 in x2. Then this probability is equal to 0. Because in this case, the upper bound is smaller than this lower bound. Okay, so then you can never be inside these bounds. So I find the probability 0. Otherwise, because u is a uniform random variable, we have that if fx1 is bigger than 1 minus fx2 in x2, then the probability that u is in between these bounds is just the length of the interval. So it's fx1 in x1 plus fx2 in x2 minus 1. So it's basically this minus this. And then you see that this is the same as saying that we should take the maximum of fx1 in x1 plus fx2 in x2 minus 1. I take this value, or I take 0, whatever is the biggest. And it ends the proof. In this video, I defined what is a Coppola function C. And then I showed you two special cases, the comonotonic and the countermonotonic Coppola. So Cu was the comonotonic Coppola, and Cl, the countermonotonic Coppola. So Cu, Cl are important Coppolas because they are linked to very extreme dependent structures. The comonotonic Coppola is linked to an extreme positive dependent structure. The Cl Coppola, the countermonotonic Coppola, is linked to an extreme negative dependent structure. You can also prove that this inequality holds. So any Coppola C is bounded from above by the comonotonic Coppola, is bounded from below by the countermonotonic Coppola. And we will see a proof of this result in a separate video. If we then use Sklar's theorem, we can prove this inequality and this inequality. So assume that you have a random vector x1, x2, and for this random vector, you know what are the marginal distributions. So you know fx1, you know fx2. Then remember that this probability here, the joint CDF, is the probability that x1 is smaller than x1, x2 smaller than x2. So for the moment, assume that these values x1, x2 are very small values. So then the joint CDF in x1, x2 is a probability that the random variable x1 and the random variable x2 take small values at the same time. So we look at an extreme probability. X1, x2 very small at the same time. Then these inequalities tell you that this extreme probability, so the probability that x1, x2 are small at the same time, this probability is maximized when you have commonicity between your random variables x1, x2. This probability is minimized when you have countermonotonicity for your random variables, which is, I think, I hope, intuitively clear. If your random variables x1, x2 are moving strong together, it is more likely that they are both moving down at the same time and hence take small values. If they are moving in the opposite direction, x1 becoming very small, the probability that x2 is becoming very large is larger. So it's less likely that they are both small at the same time when they are moving in opposite direction. So therefore, countermonotonicity minimizes the probability that x1, x2 are very small at the same time.